The message is, take your Bibles and turn to 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1. In the title, I don't know why it was left off, but it was, but the message is the fruits of suffering for Christ's sake. It's the motivation of Christ's sake. And our apostle understood that his ministry, and our ministry too, because we follow him, he's going to say in the Philippians, it's given unto us not only to believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, but to suffer for his name's sake. And when you talk to people in the grace movement, a lot of times they say, well, we talk to family members, we talk to friends, but they didn't want to hear this. Well, praise the Lord. You know, as long as you're faithful in discharging your debt as an ambassador. We have an enemy who hates the Lord Jesus Christ, and he hates us. So the opposition of the satanic policy of evil in this religious system, this world system, is set up with a course that Satan set up from the beginning of Cain. It's still here, a counterfeit religious system. So the opposition is supposed to be there. Sometimes the challenge, though, is the motivation to go out and to serve the Lord by faith. Don't worry about being rejected. They're not rejecting you and I. They're rejecting him when you do it for Christ's sake. And what I want to talk about this morning is the motivation, understanding the doctrinal progression. Brother Ted laid the foundation yesterday for us to talk about the fruits of righteousness. And there's fruits that come from suffering. It's eternal glorification of our Savior. That's what this is all about. It's not about us. It's about him. That's why God the Father said, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. And the Apostle Paul understood that he could say, for me to live is Christ. And die is gain. Get to die part two. Can I gain? And can it be? So, but there's a doctrinal progression of going from being a babe in Christ, milk doctrine, to getting to the edification process where you're a fully functioning, perfect man in Christ. You're able to go out and do the work in the ministry. You're able to be in the battle. Because you guys are aware we're in a spiritual battle. And Satan hates what we're doing right now. He hates the proclamation of the grace message with clarity and no confusion, but he hates more to see you function in your identity in Christ day by day. Not being here, but wherever you go, because the life of Christ is the issue, not mine. And one day, we're going to see him. And there's a place of evaluating our work down here. So the question is going to be, who are you serving today? And is the motivation of the messages this week enough to take us back home and do the work in the ministry? So let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to preach your word and to function as ambassadors for Christ and ministers of reconciliation and to with Paul to endure hardness as good soldiers. So as we go through this lesson, as briefly as we can, just give us clarity of thought and understanding to glorify our Savior. Because he's worthy. In Christ's name we pray and give thanks. Amen. 2 Timothy, let me get my glasses out. Paul's last epistle, there's an admonition to Timothy. Starting verse number 3. I thank God whom I serve for my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful, underline this, of thy tears, that I might be filled with joy. Now, you know the setting. Paul is about to be beheaded. He's about to be offered. Time of his offerings at hand. And Timothy is his son in the faith. He sees his father in the faith about to be killed. And Timothy saw the opposition from the saints who had turned away from Paul's distinctive ministry and message. And so he went into depression. Timothy got in the beds and pulled the covers over his head and shut the blinds and didn't want to come out. And Paul said, I'm reminded of your tears. He was crying, folks. Wouldn't you? But Paul reminds him of something. If you come down to verse number 7, for God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor me his prisoner, but be thou a partaker, here it is, the sufferings of Christ, of the afflictions of the gospel, according to the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. And folks, that's what it is. It's God's eternal purpose. We've been made partakers through the Lord Jesus Christ of God's divine purpose. Your eternal destiny is already set, folks. It's already set because of the victory program we're in. We're not in a program of defeat unless you look at circumstances in yourself. But when you set your affections on the Lord Jesus Christ, you understand he's already accomplished the victory for us eternally. Now the fruit should come because I want to serve him. Why wouldn't I want to serve the one that loved me and gave himself for me? Maybe I don't really appreciate the spiritual doctrinal understanding of the growth process. Maybe I'm still drinking milk. You know, that's what babes do, right? And I'm not eating meat. I'm not able to go out and understand not only how my salvation happened, but to understand what the Bible talks about godly edification, how to begin to learn our identity in Christ, not only as our initial justification and sanctification, but also to come to a point of maturity that I can go teach others also. That's the goal of the ministry. And a lot of times folks ask the question, well, we don't have anybody to meet. I always say, go find some new people. You don't have to deal with your family members. Go find some new people. Somebody out there wants to know about the justification that happened at Calvary. You know that, don't you? All you got to do is be willing to open your mouth and give them the clarity of the gospel. Somebody's I'm going to make you to be fishers of men. So they don't know this message. Satan's power of darkness and his ungodly program of keeping our gospel hid, they don't know it. We go tell them and bring them light. Wherever they're at, if they're next door neighbors, if they're family members, if they're in the grocery store, if they're in the restaurant, go talk to them in a kind way. And I don't want to say something while I'm saying this. You don't go bully them. You don't go fight them. Paul talks about being gentle and kind towards one another. You go with a spirit of humility, not pride. The Bible says that knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. And I've often said this, and sometimes to me, I'm not saying this is you guys, but my initial understanding of sound doctrine edification, I didn't understand the issue was to produce the life of Christ in me, to produce his heart, his kindness, his gentleness, his love, because the love of Christ constrains us. So once I understand that, then I love. People are not our enemies, folks. They're not. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. The opposition comes from the forces of evil that's under Satan's authority, not folks. Now, yeah, can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Ted did that yesterday. I thought you guys can hear me, but I can hear me now, so. Can you hear me better? My dear wife's supposed to do like this. She keeps track of me. Okay, thank you. Too late. All right, so. All right, I'm on a timer, okay? I can't crack jokes. I can't take left turns. Acts chapter 9. So when Paul's ministry started, Acts chapter 9, he understood from the beginning, Acts chapter 9, what his purpose was, what his calling was. And we're going to look at the verse that talks about the gift of suffering. Don't you want that gift? We have the gift of eternal life. There's another gift, folks. Don't we say we follow Paul? Yeah, it's more than just following him in terms of dotting I's and crossing T's that Paul's our apostle. He is. He's the apostle of the Gentiles. But we follow him not only in the message that was committed to him, the doctrinal edification, Romans and Philemon, but also in the sufferings. Now, there's a price for that. There's a price for that. So I can't do it. Timothy couldn't do it. Timothy got his eyes off the Lord. He stopped looking at the goal of the ministry. We're going to see him at the judgment seat of Christ, folks. Nobody's going to escape. And you know what I like about that? You can't blame me for what you didn't learn. You can't blame me for saying, well, Pastor Shepherd taught this. What say of the scriptures? You need that feedback? Okay. We're going to all give an account of ourselves. So I don't look at today. I look out there. That's where I want to be approved by the Lord. I don't know why that stack's coming in. Okay, Acts chapter 9. Let's get on with it.
excuse me, verse 13. This is Ananias after Paul was saved, or Saul of Tarsus. Verse 13. And then Ananias answered, Lord, I've heard by many of this man, talking about Saul of Tarsus, how much evil he have done to thy saints of Jerusalem. And he hath authority from the chief priests to bind all that call upon thy name. Now watch the Lord's response to Ananias. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel, for I will show him how great things he must suffer. Why? For my name's sake. That's the sufferings of Christ, folks. That's not just the sufferings of this present time. We're going to look at that if we have time. For the initial first doctrinal edification in Romans that prepares you to understand how the doctrine's laid out. Because if you understand the sufferings of Christ, the next phase of that is the sufferings for Christ's sake. The sufferings of this present time, I'm sorry. And it's going to be for Christ's sake, not for my sake. Now, you husbands, I was going to say something. I had to filter my thoughts about being a husband. I'll just say it says, husband, love your wives. How about that one? That's the Lord's command to me, right? And I'm not going to say I'm suffering for that. Because if it's the love of Christ, I can love my wife, right? But that's godliness in my home. That should be put on display that my wife sees that. The kindness, the mind I have towards her, like the Lord Jesus Christ has towards us. How much did he love us? He gave himself for us. Wow. That's a sacrificial love. Come on to Acts chapter 14. Verse 19. Acts chapter 14, verse 19. And there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium, which persecuted the people, having stoned Paul, and drew him out of the city, supposing he had died. Howbeit, as the disciples, we're talking about the sufferings for Christ's sake, stood about him, he rose up and came into the city, and the next day he departed into Barnabas and Derbe. And when he had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue the faith, and that we through much what? Tribulation and enter the kingdom of God. See, Paul understood his ministry. They hated the Lord Jesus Christ, so they hated Paul. When Satan understood that the program changed from Israel's kingdom program to the dispensation of grace, and he heard about the revelation of the mystery, his ire came towards us, the body of Christ. Right? Not the religious system, but towards the believers. Paul being an example. And then he gets stoned, 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He comes back up, and he goes right back into the city. Some of us won't go back to our family members. The man just got killed. But there was something in Paul. There was a life in Paul, folks. That's the life of Christ in us. See, the doctrine of motivation and the doctrine of design will cause us at some point when we grow to say, no longer I, but Christ that dwelleth in me. See, if it's I, that's self-centeredness, it's selfishness, it's not grace, it's flesh. So the Lord can't accept that because it has to be done for his son. Come over to Romans chapter 8. Now I'm going to do this quickly because my time is moving. But we need to start here because the first pillar of sufferings, and to anybody young that's here, there's another category I'm not going to talk about, but it's suffering for stupidity's sake. Now, everybody in here knows that, so don't act like you don't. When you don't know better, you don't do better. When you know better, you should do better. But life will teach you, don't do that anymore, right? So you can accept the fact of learning and getting the experiences to go help somebody else. But that's not the sufferings of Christ. That's not the sufferings of this present time. And by the way, I'm not going to be able to go down through the whole passage because I don't have time. But the sufferings of this present time, my daughter, we were coming here yesterday, and my two granddaughters, well, my granddaughter and her friend were in the car, 14, and Nikki, 38, right? Ladies land on the expressway, throwing up in Detroit, right by the airport. I'm talking about the major expressway. Comes around by the passenger side that got out, and the man stops so he doesn't run over the lady, and my daughter runs in the back of him. See, yesterday, they could have went home and be with the Lord, but I knew where they went. That's part of the sufferings of this present time. None of us are exempt from that, right? Depression, getting old, forgetting the memory loss, right? Chronic illnesses. I'm diabetic because I was born in Adam, right? All of us have those issues that we're dealing with. That the sufferings of the present time has a doctrinal structure of edification, that Paul received doctrine from the Lord that goes from verse 18 down to verse 39, that's designed to equip us to be able to endure it, to understand that God's not against us, he's for us. And because of the dispensation of grace change, static still there? I can hear the static. Is that better? Yeah, because Israel program had signs and wonders. So if you got sick, he was the Lord God that healeth thee, right? If you got in trouble, then he was the Lord God, Nisi, Jehovah Nisi. If you needed peace, he was the God of peace there too, right? If you needed a shepherd, that was their program. That's not ours.
That's it.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so it starts in verse 18. For the sufferings of this present time are not worthy. Notice this. The present time sufferings is in the but now, the dispensation of grace. God Almighty, we said to Israel's program aside, I'm sure you guys know this. He said all their sign gifts, their miracles, their wonders. And that doesn't operate today. It's in the scriptures, but it's not in our program today. So it's called the sufferings of this present time. And I know some of you all, and I'm talking to some of you guys, and some of you all are part of my ministry, and I know everybody's going through something, right? Amen? You might just have some children that are rebellious. See, she put her hand up. We got 10. They're not all rebellious, but boy, okay, I'm seeing a whole lot of hands come up now. Anyway, those are part of the sufferings of this present time, right? So when Paul starts talking about that, but watch what he says, he makes a comparison. It's not worthy to be compared with the glory that's going to be revealed in us. So he's not talking about your new glorified body. He's talking about the glorification of the Lord Jesus Christ throughout eternity. That's the issue. It's the glorification of Christ, folks, by his Father. Didn't he say, this is my beloved son in whom I'm, y'all know these verses, don't you? In whom I'm well pleased. The glorification is God's son throughout eternity, and we get to share in his glory. Now, you're going to get a glorified body, but that's not the issue of the glory that's going to be revealed in us. And you know what? What's amazing about that? We're going to look at a verse if we get time. He's going to call what we go through right now light afflictions. Do they seem light at times?
No.
But he's going to say they're working for you a far more exceeding and eternal way. No, it's eternal way to glory. But you can't look at your circumstances because we walk by faith and not by sight. But you know, if you don't have the word of God in you, you can't walk by faith because faith comes by hearing. I like this crowd. They know the verses, man. And hearing by the word of God, not the world system. And God's will is that we don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by renewing our mind. Renewed mind comes through getting in the word of God daily. Not when I just go to service on Sunday. You got to eat the word of God daily. My wife and I always tell our family and our children, our saints, you know, the order this morning was not done right. When Adam and Eve met the Lord in the garden in the cool of the day, they came for breakfast. He was going to feed them his word. And then they were going to eat the physical bread. The spiritual comes first, right? So we got out of order. Y'all went and ate dinner, breakfast. So you're supposed to come here and eat the spiritual food first. So I guess we got to move the program up to 7 o'clock. But that's what they did because you eat the spiritual first daily. So when you get up there, the old said, I esteem the words of thy lips more than my necessary food. Job said, Jeremiah said, thy words were found and I did eat them. And thy words were unto me a joy and rejoice in my heart because I'm called by your name. That should be the joy of your heart. And I know some people work and they don't have time. But folks, when you get up in the morning or all day long, just spend time reading God's word. It'll strengthen your inner man. It'll give you stability and faith and joy against the satanic policy of evil, against the course of this world, against the world system is not going to get better. Y'all know that, don't you? Okay. The only one that's going to set up the world system that gets better is when the Lord Jesus Christ comes back. None of the political systems, not economic. Look, it's supposed to be falling apart because Adam's in control. But when the Lord Jesus Christ sets up his kingdom, my goodness, what a day of rejoicing that's going to be. So we go down through the edification process. This is the first design. So for verse number 18 to verse number 20, let me put my glasses on, 23, he talks about the issue of the glory and the redemption of our bodies. Then you go down to verse 26 to verse number 27, he talks about the intercessionary ministry of the Holy Spirit when you don't know what to pray for to bring stability and peace. Then he goes down from verse 28 to down to verse number 30 about the certainty of God's counsel. You know, God's counsel cannot be stopped. I love what it said in Romans chapter 4. God who calls those things that are not as though they were. He's already called in eternity our identity and our position in Christ. And nothing can stop it. You can't stop it. I can't stop it. Satan can't stop it. We're in the victory program. Then he starts to go down to verse number 31. And he starts to deal with those wonderful things about God being for you. In verse number 32, well, let me start verse 31. What shall we say then to those things? If God be what? For us. God's for you, folks. Who can be against us? God's for you. I don't care what your circumstances. Now, remember what he's done with the sufferings of this present time. And Paul begins to have a doctrinal understanding of what God, the Holy Spirit, gave him to have the capacity to be able to endure it. So the first thing he starts talking about in this passage, God's for you. His power is for you. His grace for you. His love is for you. God is for you. All these attributes of God are for you, folks. They're not against you. When you are going through circumstances and situations in your life, look at Calvary. You'll see that God is for you. He's so much for you that he loved you and he gave himself for you through his son. Were you worthy? No. Christ died for who? The ungodly. When we were without strength in due time, Christ died for us. The issue of the justice of God is settled in Romans chapter 1 to 5, that God's for you, folks. So when you get over here in the sanctification area, he begins to talk about the issue of how God's for you. Come down to verse number. And by the way, the last thing is verse 35. The love of God is for you. Power of God, the grace of God, the justice of God, and the love of God. They're for you. The components of God's attributes and characteristics. Verse number, and then he quotes David. By the way, verse number 35, he changed to verse number 34. Who is he that condemneth? Verse number 33. Who shall lay and think the charge of God's elect? Verse number 35. Who is Satan? Now he brings in the satanic policy of evil against us too, because he's going to begin to talk about the sufferings of Christ. For Christ's sake. And then he begins to talk about verse 36. He quotes David in Psalms 44. When the tribulation saints, the circumcision believers are going through the time of tribulation, when the policy of evil is out to annihilate them and get rid of the nation of Israel, and they're going through a time of trouble that the Lord says in Luke chapter 21 that men's hearts will be failing them because of fear of the things they see, because of fear. And the remnant's looking at that and they're wondering, where are you at? Yeah, but they got some doctrine too, folks. And David quotes that in Psalms 44. And when Paul quotes that, he says, verse 36, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. But what's the answer to that? What does God, the Holy Spirit, teach him? Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors. Now, we're talking about the foundation first before we get to the sufferings of Christ. Because you're already conquerors, folks. You're more than conquerors. The very thing that was supposed to destroy you, God gives you the victory in it, no matter what it is. Then he says this. He goes, now, I'm going to ask you a question. Well, more than conquerors through him that loved us, for I am persuaded. Now, Paul's persuaded by the doctrine he's just taught. Y'all with me? He's not just persuaded because they sing a song and they come to a service on Sunday and everybody loves each other or hates each other. But he's persuaded by some doctrine that he just taught us. So I'm going to encourage you to go home and read that and read it and read it so it gets in your inner man. Then he begins to talk about neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers, no things present, no things to come, nor height. Matter of fact, if we go back to the issue about separating us from verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? No. Or distress? No. Look at the next one. Persecution. You know, aren't they talking about the grocery shelves are going to be empty coming up? So folks are going to go in there and buy everything off the shelves. Well, if it does, it's not the first time of famine. Who are you going to trust? You going to trust in the living God or you going to trust in man? That's a good question. I'm going to trust in the living God because I belong to him, right? But Paul talked about famine. It's not the first time in the Bible. But God's going to provide for you, not supernaturally, providentially. I'm not saying don't use wisdom. You know, we just came back, I guess I can put Africa in now, from Lusaka, Zambia. We had the privilege of going there, my wife and I, with Brother Dez. Extraordinary. And I think one of the many things that really impacted me is how wealthy this country is and how selfish people are in this country. How we don't appreciate all the riches of this country and all the things we have. I came back home, got off the plane, I went to Costco's. Because I didn't see that in Zambia. The shelves weren't bare, but the foods we eat and the resources we have, and quite frankly, I'm sure it's the same in your neighborhood. I can go 5 minutes in my neighborhood, go to 10 different significantly large grocery stores. Sam's Club, Costco's, or it's called Myers. You can too, can't you? So, you know, I go in and I say, man, these folks weren't about food. Some of us maybe need to stop eating as much food. I guess I shouldn't have said that, should I? But anyway, it's just too much, right? And so famine might be a part of that, but it can't separate us from the love of God. Last verse says, neither can height nor death nor any other creature be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So the love of God is for you. The justice of God is for you. The grace of God is for you. The power of God is for you. The ministry of the Holy Spirit comes in and helps you in your infirmities. The counsel of God, we know that all things work together for good. Not everything's good, but for them who love God, to them who are called, get this one, according to his purpose. We're part of God's purpose. The creator of heaven and earth has an eternal purpose that he created before the world began. And he revealed it to Paul in the mystery program about the accomplishments of that cross. And the church, the body of Christ, participate in the eternal glorification of the Lord Jesus Christ in the heavenly places forever. So that's why that verse, I don't know if we're going to get to it, but if you suffer with him, what's going to happen? Rain. Yeah, the sufferings there. It's talking about the sufferings of Christ. Now, we have a friend who says he's okay just parking cars. In other words, I'm not going to suffer for them. And dead people around you, everywhere you go. Anyway, come over to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. So the doctrine of the foundation of the sufferings of Christ are in Paul's personal experiences. And there's a progression of doctrinal understanding that Paul was taught by the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's not like, you know, it's verses when you get in the book of Acts that Paul is afraid. Y'all know that, don't you? He said he had the sentence of death within himself, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God that raiseth the dead. I think he knew that because he was resurrected from the dead when they stoned him. Wow. Maybe he understood that from his own life's experiences with the dispensation of grace. But you begin to have categories. So I'm going to start over here in chapter 4, verse 7. And he starts with the issue of the word of God, verse number 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Why? The purpose, the intent, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. The issue of having earthen vessels, and if you've gotten older, I had to tell our brother, we were singing, that, you know, it's going to say here, the outward man is perishing. The child who was up here yesterday, I'm not going back to that child. I'm not going to be a babe again. The body's getting old. You can't tell it, but I'm getting old. Every time you see me, you'll see me getting old, right? Because my outward man is perishing. But guess what? So is yours. But the issue is not the outward man. It's the inward man that's being renewed day by day. Then he says this. I might as well quote it to you. Our light afflictions. What do you mean light afflictions? My daughter and my granddaughter were in almost an accident. It didn't happen. But my dear wife loves our children, and I can hear her heart fluttering. Because if your child's gone, that's pain. And some of y'all have lost children. Some of y'all have lost parents. Some of y'all have lost mates. He calls that a light affliction and light of eternity. Because it's working for us a far more exceeding and eternal way to glory. Then he says this, and come down to verse number 10. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ. Talking about the sufferings of Christ now. Why? Now watch this. Always, all the way to the end. Always. Bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ. That the life, notice this, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest where? In our bodies. For we which are live are always. Now difference always, all the way to the end. Always. All the way to the end, always, every day, every situation I come into. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake. Whose sake is it for? For Christ's sake. See the sake there? Why? That the life also of Jesus might be made manifest, where? In our mortal. What happens, folks, is the doctrine resident in your inner man, when life's pressure comes and life's situations and you have the spirit Paul talks about of faith, verse number 11, we have the same spirit of faith. When you put faith in the doctrine, it's not the outward man that's the issue in the dispensation of grace, it's your inner man. Your inner man consists of your spirit and your soul, and is strengthened by his spirit with what? With might. That's where the power of God's at. Your outer man is not the issue, it's the inner man. But if you don't have some doctrine in your inner man, you're going to faint. You're going to give up, you're going to quit. You're going to say, Lord, why is this happening to me? No, it's not that. It's the sufferings of this present time or the sufferings of Christ. But you have to decide willingly to enter into the sufferings of Christ. You cannot avoid the sufferings of this present time, but you can avoid the sufferings for Christ's sake. That's a choice. Do you want to know him in a different way? The way that God the Father wants you to know. Do you understand that God the Father is glorified when the life of Christ is manifested in our mortal flesh? He's going to say whether it be by life or death. Wow. But there's a doctrinal edification that over here Paul begins to learn how to endure it. He doesn't go over there where he's going to say that I might know him, that I want it. But there's a process of growth that happens. That is a babe, you got to get over here. A babe's not going to endure it because a babe's a babe. But when you become a perfect man in understanding and edification and spiritual doctrinal strength, yeah, you become old. I call myself Russell the Aged today. I do. Young men are coming behind us. I'm going off the scene, right? My time's been here. I don't know how long. I don't want too much longer time. About 20 years. We have a brother who comes on our broadcast that we have, and he was in our hospital. He was dying. And he came on a couple weeks ago, Saturday, yesterday, about 3 weeks. And he said, I'm in your area. Now, this is suffering, so present time, but also he was suffering for Christ's sake. And I said, me and Brother Coleman, we'll be by to see you on Sunday to meet with you and pray with you. By the time we got to the hospital, he was gone home with the Lord. I'm like, thank you, Lord. It wasn't like, oh, why is this? I knew where he went. And the joy was that he had a hunger for God's word on his deathbed. Wow. What an example. And the Lord took him home. I'm going to see him soon. So are you, right? We know where those folks are at, don't we? To be absent from the body is to be what? Present. That word present means present tense, right now. We're present here. One day we're going to be present there. I don't know my last day is coming, but I want to be approved by the Lord. The issue of learning how to endure. Look at verse number 16. For which cause we faint not. That's the issue of enduring. But though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed. And it's a day by day issue, right? Then he says that word for is a further explanation. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, in light of eternity. What is he doing? He's working for us. A far more exceeding. And Paul's our example. He's showing us not only about the understanding of the dispensation of grace has the sufferings of this present time, but also the choice and the privilege and the honor. Did you know what I just said? The choice and the privilege and the honor to suffer for his name's sake. Because if the Lord Jesus Christ was here right now, they still would hate him without a cause. They still would crucify him or kill him. Matter of fact, the Lord Jesus Christ was here right now, we wouldn't be here as Gentiles. Right? So the privilege of being Gentiles in the dispensation of grace is a real privilege. That we're God's people now for a time. Now watch what he says. Verse number 16. For while we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. How do you see the things which are not seen? By faith. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So the first thing of the doctrine of edification is you learn how to endure. Come to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. You all know these verses. But I kind of just want to remind us, and my purpose, hopefully, is to motivate the saints of the privilege in the age of grace to put us in remembrance of the sufferings of Christ to please the Father. This is Paul when he's stoned, and I want to get to a certain part of the passage. Let's start verse 8 for time's sake. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice. He's talking about the infirmity of his flesh, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. Paul got new revelation in the dispensation of grace. For my strength is made perfect in your strength. My strength is made perfect where? The very thing we don't want to be, in our weakness. Then he says, now watch this. Here's another level of edification. Most gladly, therefore, wow, will I rather glory in mine infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities. Oh, there's the next one. In persecution, in distress. Why? For Christ's sake. That's the sufferings of Christ. Now, he's not enduring it only. He's taking pleasure in it. Come over with me to Philippians. So, in Paul's epistles, we're going from milk doctrine to meat doctrine. We're going through Paul's edification process. That's in his epistles from Romans Philemon, where he starts teaching milk in Romans. Then as he goes through this doctrine progression, you get over Philippians, Colossians, and Ephesians. Now he's teaching those who are full age, who are able to understand the battle and be a part of it. Philippians chapter 1, talking about the fruits of suffering for Christ's sake, verse 11. This is for time's sake, folks. He's talking about Timothy, the Philippian saints, rather. And he's talking about, now Paul's in prison right now. And then he says, being filled, verse 11, being filled with the what? Fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God. Come down to verse 22. Let's go back to verse number 20. According to my earnest expectation and my hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ should be manifest in my body, whether it be by life or death. For to me to live is Christ. For to me to live is Christ. For to me to live is Christ. That's not something you put on your refrigerator. That's a thinking process of a renewed mind. Paul didn't say for you and I to live is Christ. He said for me to live is Christ. I have to say that for me. There's a personal accountability now, folks. For me to live is Christ. Not Russell, and to die is what? Man, and can it be? And can it be about my Savior leaving his throne in glory to come down and find little sinners like us, reconcile them out of Satan's power of darkness, translate us into the kingdom of his dear Son, to one day put us on display with him in glory? Why wouldn't you want to live for him? Why wouldn't you want to serve? Nobody else has done that for me. How about you? No. I answer it for you. No. Only my Savior. My Savior and my Lord. And then he says this. I got 8 minutes. I'm looking at the clock. Verse 22. For if I live in the flesh. Now he's talking about the sufferings of Christ. This is the fruit of my what? Labor. You know, if you're laboring somewhere, if you have a garden or you're planting something, you got to go out there and do some work, don't you? The fruit just doesn't come up by accident. So Paul was laboring in the work of the ministry. And so are we to labor and follow him in that respect. We know who our apostle is, but when he says, be ye followers of me as I follow Christ, I'm going to ask you about this next verse that we're going to look at. Because initially he endures it, then he takes pleasure in it. You're going to see he's going to learn how to rejoice in it. Then he's going to say, just give it to me. He's a fully functioning, mature believer who's wants us to follow him. Watch what he says in verse number 23. Well, I'm in a strait between two, having to depart, desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. And isn't it that? Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. That my, verse 26, that my rejoicing might be more abundant in Jesus Christ. By the way, in the beginning of the book of Philippians, he talks about the bowels of Jesus Christ. And Paul's heart to us as believers in the dispensation of grace would be the Lord's heart towards us. How he would want to value us and to take divine viewpoint on his ministry and the purpose that God gave him as the apostle of the Gentiles, to have divine viewpoint, not human viewpoint. Now notice verse number, we got 6 minutes. Verse 28. And in nothing, now the Philippian saints are following Paul. The Corinthian saints in the beginning didn't. They were carnally minded. They served the world system and they hated Paul. Because to follow Paul, you're going to suffer. If you really follow him and his sufferings, right, in his edification process. Verse 28, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries. No, they got adversaries, folks, which is them an evident token of perdition, but to you, salvation, that of God, suffering deliverance from the emotional pain of being rejected. It's not salvation from justification or being taken out this world. It's the misery that Timothy was going through and the depression because he was afraid. And you should get afraid at times. But don't forget, God has not given us a spirit of fear. So where does it come from? Satan. He wants you to quit. That you're in a battle. And his policy of evil is to cause you to be discouraged and want to quit. And how many people do that? How many believers do that? Yeah. Hey. But anyway, he says, verse number 29, for unto you it is given on behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, comma, but also to suffer for his name's sake. Are you suffering for Christ? For his sake? Not for stupidity, not to suffer in this present time, but because of his glorification. Not only here, Romans chapter 8, 6, 7, 8 is the issue of functional life. You know, it's amazing that sometimes the misunderstanding of not the imputation of righteousness from the justice of God because of Romans chapter 1, verse 5, being justified by faith, you have peace with God, but the issue of the holiness of God. That's what grace is, folks. We have a nature that's in us that wants to understand the issue of our holiness and our sanctification in Christ. Okay? That's our sanctification. When you do that, you're not being conformed to the world. And the world's going to hate you. Now, they take a stand for their stuff, don't they? Don't they put it all in your face? Don't they say, you're not with us? You hate us? No, we love you because God loves you. Yeah, anyway. Did you catch the last part? But also to suffer for his name's sake. Come over to chapter 3. So Paul goes from enduring it to taking pleasure in it. You all know the verse, verse 10. We'll just jump down there. We got one more verse. Yeah, we got more verses, but we're going to get to them. Verse 10. So when he talks about his growth, that I might know him, and the power of his resurrection, by the way, this is over Ephesians chapter 1, 2. And the fellowship of his what? Wow. There's a fellowship of this. Being made conformable unto his death. Then he talks about the issue of the life of Christ, verse 11. That's that the ecstasy of the power of God might be of God, not of us. My wife's looking at me. I'm going to say something wrong. Okay. You got to look at my wife, you know, Brother Dave. Come over to Colossians. Colossians chapter 1. I thought about the issue when Brother Ted talked about the fruits of righteousness. There's another fruit, folks. It's the fruits of righteousness for Christ's sake and his sufferings when we follow Paul. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. I guess I got to stop. I had 2 minutes on my clock because we were doing something else if the thing weren't working. Oh, that's what she's doing. She's telling me it's time to stop. I got to be obedient. If you want the rest of the message, come see me later on. Because he's going to talk about with Timothy. Don't be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord or me, his prisoner. Be thou a partaker of the afflictions of the gospel. According to what? The power of God. Man, don't be ashamed of the Lord nor our apostle. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for the fellowship. Thank you for your word. Thank you for edification. And thank you for the privilege of being one of your members of your body. We give thanks in our Savior's name, who loved us and gave himself for us. We pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Yeah, thank you.